CEO and Managing Director of Tata Power. Mr. Sinha, good morning. Thank you for joining us. Always a pleasure to connect with you. Mr. Sinha, first things first. According to the reported data, August electricity supply was down by 1.3%. Can we blame it on slowdown, or can we blame it on rains, or can we blame it on both?
Good morning, Nikunj. Always a pleasure to be on your show. Yes, the August consumption patterns have come down, but I think it's a trend which we are observing in the power sector, that last 1 year the sector has been through huge challenges, typically because all the DISCOMs are facing financial crisis. They are not in a position to pay for the power that they purchase, and also their ability to buy more power is governed by the fact that they do not have money to buy additional power. So I think all in all, the power sector is in very difficult condition. The fundamentals are not very good, and until and unless the distribution reforms happens in a big way, we would continue to face this challenge. And of course, what we have seen, that the typical growth over a 12-month period, if we look at it, has again reduced. It has shrunk over a period of time because the consumptions in the market has reduced, the purchase of equipments, electronics by domestic consumers, the industrial production has come down. So all in all, there is definitely a contraction in demand, and this actually needs to change over a period of time.
Now, Mr. Sinha, some would argue how the Uday One scheme fared out. Now, whether it's good or bad, that's a separate debate. But if we talk about what the Uday Two scheme is being proposed about, do you think Uday Two is going to be a scheme which should be implemented but will be hard to implement, because it is talking about very stringent norms for DISCOMs? Now, one side is that DISCOMs don't have money. But if DISCOMs do not have money, they will not be able to buy power at all. And if they are not able to buy power at all, then we are looking at not electricity shortage, but electricity crisis. Can Uday Two be really implemented?
Well, we need to look at Uday One was more of the financial restructuring that was done. And Uday Two, if at all it has to come, it has to more encompassing rather than just financial restructuring of the DISCOMs and their losses. So if we are looking at the big ticket reforms, then the whole sector reform has to happen, and it cannot be on a piecemeal basis that few areas are reformed and the others are left out. So what is important is that while there has been a lot of capacity additions in last 10 to 15 years, and there has been a large scale improvement in the transmission network, the distribution improvement has not happened to the extent it should have happened, notwithstanding the fact that we had IPDS programs and Deen Dayal Upadhyaya programs, and we had also very many other initiatives which the government took, including the Saubhagya program. But the fundamental reforms which the distribution companies have to go through has not happened. Their AT&C losses continues to be very, very high. Their services to their consumers does not again evoke too much of confidence amongst the consumers, and the technology interventions that should have happened in the utilities have not happened. So until and unless there is a large scale reform that takes place, which may mean either privatizing the distribution company or having franchisee arrangements or multiple supply companies, we would only be seeing partial improvements, and we will not see the full benefit of the improvements that is planned from them.
Mr. Sinha, regarding Mundra, while Gujarat has given an approval, two of the other beneficiary states, Haryana, Maharashtra, they have assembly elections coming up. So do you think perhaps that we can expect any consent before elections, or will we have to wait further?
Uh, I think that as far as Maharashtra and Haryana is concerned, it will have to wait for the elections to get over, and possibly in the month of November, December, we should be able to see the action from both these states. In fact, in Maharashtra, the cabinet note is ready, and it has to go to the cabinet, but because of the election, it may get delayed. The good news is that Punjab, the things have been sorted out, and the cabinet note is getting ready, and hopefully in next few weeks it will go to the cabinet, and that approval will come in place. We also expect more traction in Rajasthan, which has been waiting for some of the other states to take a decision. So I think we expect later part of this year that the decision will come from all these states. Fundamentally, all of them are keen that this gets resolved. They understand that even with the tariff revision, it would still be in merit order, and they are very keen to pursue that this project continues, and they pursue to procure power from here. So I don't think we have any challenge as such, but yes, it's taking time, and I'm sure this will happen sooner than later.
I wanted to understand, do you expect any meaningful impact from any coal mining regulation changes in Indonesia? Because your own mining license expires in 2022, do you expect it to get renewed?
Yeah, we are very confident of it getting renewed. We are one of the biggest coal mining companies and one of the biggest exporter of coal from there. And this mine has been giving a lot of revenue to the government. And the existing laws which are there allows for the mine to be renewed. So I don't think there is any challenge as such. The law requires that 2 years before the expiry we should go to the coal authorities and the ministry over there for renewal, and we plan to do that in January of 2020, and we expect that in next year we will be in a position to get the extension. That's what our discussions with the government and our partner in Indonesia has been indicated.
Get this one wrong, Mr. Sinha. There is a apprehension in the market amongst brokerage fraternity. As the two handful of brokerage reports on Tata Power, all of them are saying that your plants, your lease is up for renewal, and that could have an impact on your cost. What you are communicating to us via this medium to your shareholders and our viewers is that you are reasonably confident, not confident but certain, that the Indonesian mine lease would be extended and there will be no price impact or escalation.
Yeah, we are very confident about it, and we are the biggest taxpayers in Indonesia. So to that extent, the government over there respects us for the quality of work that we do, and they feel very confident that we would be able to continue the good work in future also. So in all our discussions with the government authorities and also with our partners, our understanding is that this will definitely happen, because for the government this is a high revenue earning business, and they would like us to continue this because the government, large part of the GDP comes from the export of coal, and KPC is one of the largest coal mining companies in Indonesia.
Mr. Sinha, where do you think the total accumulated losses of Mundra currently would settle? The norms have been changed, but even the norms have been changed, their Mundra business is not back in black. That is our understanding. The understanding is that losses have come down, but you are still losing. Where do you think the Mundra business is headed?
Well, Mundra business, even with the tariff revision, will not become absolutely black. We will continue to be under recovery, and we expect that whatever is the cost of coal, because it is actually dependent on cost of coal, 50% improvement will happen in that. So when the cost of coal was $90, we had an under recovery of about 85 to 90 paisa. We expect that if the cost of coal reduces to 70, it will come down to about 65 paisa. So we will have about 50% deduction because of the HPC recommendation, and we expect that over a period of time we'll be able to improve certain efficiency parameters in the plant, and that benefit will also come. So we do expect to reduce our losses to a very large extent, and whatever loss we reduce will to that extent help us in reducing or improving our profitability, because it straight away goes to our bottom line. Secondly, we also need to look at it that Mundra and the coal mining company are naturally hedged. So when the coal prices goes down, the profitability of the coal company reduces. If the coal prices goes up, the profitability increases, and to that extent there is more or less a natural hedge between the Mundra tariff and also the coal company profit. So I think all in all we expect that with the present arrangement which is being proposed now, we should be able to reduce our losses. Like last financial year we had a loss of about 1700 crores. We expect that to reduce by nearly 50% if on the same price basis. Of course this year we have seen that the prices of coal have come down, and our last year loss of about 1700 crores will possibly come down to about 1100 to 1200 crores, and with the benefit of HPC coming in, we expect that our losses will further reduce by another 5 to 600 crores.
Also wanted to understand if you are looking at divesting any of your non-core assets.
Yeah, we have actually gone ahead. In fact, day before yesterday only we signed the agreement for sale of the Synergy plant in South Africa. So that has been done. We are also now working on divesting from our other investment, that is the Zambian investment, and we hope to complete that in this financial year. We are also looking at some of the other divestments that we are looking at, some of the international divestments, and hopefully in next 1 year we will have 3 to 4 more divestments that will happen and thereby pay down our total debt at this stage.
We have a debt of about 50,000 crore. Where do you think this number will settle by end of this fiscal, by end of next fiscal?
Yeah, about what one needs to look at it that while we are on one side reducing the debt by divesting, there is also a certain amount of growth that is happening. We are growing in our existing distribution and transmission business. Both our investments in Delhi and in Mumbai, we have been able to add some more capacity. Apart from that, we have also investing in the renewable business. So I think while on one side we are divesting, the money that is coming will be used in our growth business, and the absolute numbers may not come down drastically over the next few months.
Thank you so much for joining us this morning and for taking out the time. Good speaking with you and taking stock of how things stand currently. We're going to take a very quick break, but we're going to continue this conversation on this topic with Subhash Chandra Garg, the Secretary, the Power Secretary, when we come back in just a couple of moments. Do stay with us.